You are not the hero. You are the victim. Because he's out there. And he's going to get you. Neither the most technically flashy or financially successful, Human Entertainment's Clock Tower for the PlayStation 1 has always been a classic for horror fans that has maybe faded from the modern consciousness. Though it's time for a new generation to be swallowed by the dark world of one of gaming's original boogeymen, the Scissor Man. In a time when Resident Evil was the hottest thing in gaming and the medium's almost singular voice of horror, the mainstream couldn't have been less interested in the point-and-click, actionless Clock Tower. Video games have always been about creating an escape or delivering a power fantasy, but in the mid-90s, a game that wasn't a dizzying platformer or a bombastic action game was basically unheard of. Wait, there's just one bad guy and I don't get to shoot or jump on him? Today, horror is more popular and varied than ever. PT, Five Nights at Freddy's, Slender, and so on have reminded people that horror not only can work with simple gameplay mechanics, but often thrives because of them. With this popular new trend in horror and a spiritual successor, Project Scissors, in line for 2015, it's never been a better time to plan your escape route and run for your life. First things first, let's curb some confusion here. We are not talking about the game originally released as Clock Tower for the Japanese Super Famicom. Like Sweet Home, this is actually a fan-translated reproduction cartridge of a game that never came out in North America, which explains why you can't really see the logo. And this is our bread and butter, the game we're actually going to be talking about today. For the purposes of this review, we're going to be referring to this as simply The First Fear. Listen, the genealogy of the Clock Tower series is actually stupid complicated, and I'll unwrap that mess later, but for now, all I need to know is that this is actually a sequel to this. Clock Tower can be summed up in two words: run and hide. The series is known for its avant-garde approach to gameplay, which leaves the player nearly defenseless and very mortal against a bloodthirsty psychopath tirelessly stalking you or lying in wait. When you cross paths with the killer, instead of engaging in combat, you must run and frantically search for a place to hide or an object to use as a one-time use weapon. If you are caught, you must mash the buttons in a last-ditch effort to break away, though your frail constitution can only handle so much stress. So no rocket launchers or machine guns, it's just you and your wits versus a maniac killer. Clock Tower is all about chance. Sometimes they're in the room waiting for you, and sometimes they're not. And sometimes a hiding spot works, and sometimes it doesn't. This philosophy is what ties together the other spin-offs and name and only sequels. Though he only appears in the first two games, Clock Tower's most famous character is of course Scissor Man. And that's not to be confused with the iciest gangster coming out of Houston running the mixtape game! This is why I'm talking about the PlayStation 1 Clock Tower, because I feel like, in a weird twist of fate, it's the original that gets all the attention, not the sequel that actually came out over here, Joey. And it was the last true game to feature Scissor Man. Part 3 has its own unique take on the character and, maybe I'll talk about that another time, but as far as I'm concerned, this is the truest Clock Tower experience that North America ever got. It's been several years since Jennifer Simpson's harrowing escape from the clutches of Scissor Man at the Barrows Mansion. But because video games, it appears Scissor Man is back. With the help of her caretaker, Assistant Professor of Psychology Helen Maxwell, she must unearth the dark secrets of Scissor Man to vanquish him for good. Or die trying. In typical video game horror style, Clock Tower features incredibly awful voice work.
Probably the ghosts of all the kids killed here.
How terrible.
Though the script is never as inane as Resident Evil 1.
After Scissor Man, I ain't scared of no ghosts.
I'd say the story itself isn't as interesting as the journey to see the game's 8 different endings. Clock Tower's progression forks into different situations, and some are obvious yes or no prompts, and others only reveal themselves in hindsight. For example, had I gotten an item sooner in the game, I would have been able to save a friend, but since that person died, I got a less illuminating ending. The universe of Clock Tower is a dense one. One playthrough is only a fraction of the experience. The first hurdle for Clock Tower is the point-and-click interface. It does make it a tough sell. Now, I could just say, hey, it's 2014. Interface-wise, this was basically The Walking Dead of its time, and that game was brilliant, but it's a little more to it than that. You see, Clock Tower was released in Japan in December of 1996, and to the rest of the world in the next year or so. But let's keep that date in our heads, 1996. Gaming was in the final throes of its embarrassing love affair with full motion video, and just starting to experiment with polygons and true 3D graphics. Movement and camera control were rotten across the board. Neither the software nor the hardware was really equipped to handle the third dimension, and because of this, outside of a few first party games and the rare third party gem, the N64 and the PlayStation 1 were largely awash without some thick rose-colored glasses. Even well into the PlayStation 2's lifespan, developers were still struggling with decent camera controls and responsive combat. Shit, I remember playing Grand Theft Auto 4 in 2008 and thinking, oh my god, they finally got the shooting right. So again, let's go back to 1996. What was there? Well, there was Knights, which was technically 2.5D. There was Mario 64, the classic that, let's be honest, has some pretty rotten camera. Tomb Raider was an enormous hit in its day, but yo, get that reboot and do not look back. Resident Evil was a mega hit, but the infamous tank controls and stationary snapping camera were a workaround for an industry still grappling with satisfactory gameplay in a 3D environment. Keeping Clock Tower a point-and-click game, don't forget this is also how First Fear played, was not a compromise, but rather a smart way to adapt to the limits of contemporary hardware. Critics called the point-and-click gameplay old and antiquated, but Clock Tower has only gotten better with age. Though maybe not that impressive to critics in 96, Human Entertainment's decision to make it point-and-click feels like a smart move today. But that just defends the decision to keep it point-and-click. Neither this nor the First Fear innovate the form beyond making it function reliably on a D-pad. If you don't like point-and-click games, you'll likely still not enjoy Clock Tower. Interestingly though, having little direct control over your character heightens the game experience to feel more like a horror film. In previous reviews, I've mentioned the greatest distinction between horror games and horror movies is agency. For example, forcing the player to investigate the creepy basement instead of watching characters do it on screen. While there definitely is room for a horror game like Clock Tower now, there was little room in a time when video games were still trying to legitimize themselves as their own medium. Games of the era like Resident Evil and especially Silent Hill focused far more on creating a terrifying atmosphere, and they were far more financially successful for it. With limited character agency, Clock Tower masterfully tiptoes between the two forms, creating an experience I could wholly invest in a way that I couldn't quite do with its contemporaries. Well, that's not to say that Clock Tower doesn't make smart choices with its environments, just different smart choices. While the gameplay between this and First Fear are largely similar, the choice of environments and set design are streamlined in Clock Tower, making them simultaneously more simplistic and varied. Getting stuck was a huge bother in the First Fear because its mansion was so spread out with hallways that tended to feel copy-pasted. In Clock Tower, getting stuck was a factor mitigated by its smaller areas and mundane environments. College dorms, libraries, some geezer's house. So when I said to myself, oh, I haven't checked out that one room in a while, I also didn't have to spend 10-15 minutes just trying to find it. Even when you do go to the mansion at the end of the game, it's been redesigned as less winding, with most doors locked when you first arrive. Listen, at their core, these are point-and-click adventure games. You will get stuck because you didn't click that one thing, or didn't click that other thing enough times. The monotony of the genre is of course broken up by everyone's friend, the Scissor Man. Just as in First Fear, Human Entertainment populated dozens of places for him to burst from. But whereas the original felt more like hide-and-seek, here in the sequel, Scissor Man lumbers into your life seemingly at random. Your signal lies in the excellent spooky soundtrack. When the music swells and the ominous clanging steel sound fades in, that's your cue to abandon everything and scramble for a weapon or a place to hide. Clock Tower is a scary game, though I think its reputation in the annals of horror may be a little overblown, even in its time. Modern horror games like P.T. or Five Nights at Freddy's are endurances, where enjoyment is derived from, frankly, how much you don't enjoy it. Clock Tower certainly does not stack up to these games, but I still recommend it because it's, frankly, the most fun I've had being scared in a really long time. The music is very tense and never failed to get my heart pumping, and Scissor Man operates on a logic reminiscent of a Scooby-Doo cartoon. A row of lockers, a big box, a hidden door on the floor are all cause for excitement because, oh man, I bet he's in there. In one case, Scissor Man was Schrodinger's maniac, I opened up a secret door expecting Scissorman to jump out. I was so disappointed that he didn't, I opened it up again in protest. But this time, he did jump out. Does that make any sense? Not really. Did it scare the absolute crap out of me? Goddamn right it did. And was I having a blast? Absolutely. I mentioned that the branching paths and multiple endings are incentive to replay Clock Tower, but for me personally, I wanted more Scissorman. This is another example of the developers understanding the appeal of this game as they enact virtually no punishment for dying. If you are unsuccessful in your attempts to escape, or just want to see what a certain death animation looks like, you can jump right back in by continuing from the main screen. So go on! Have fun! Go nuts! Naturally, a game about a maniac with giant scissors delivers on some wonderful gory bits, as well as some pretty hilarious and absurd moments. Like, oh no, not bed sheets! And, I shit you not, where you trip him with string. Also, shouts to pausing and saving anywhere. Man, it's nice to have that in a game like this. This eases the difficulty, allowing the player to live in the moment and really explore the environment. The challenge is not trying to stay alive, it's working your way through the story and figuring out how to get the best ending. But the fun of Clock Tower is the impromptu playdates with Scissorman. One last thing I appreciate about Scissorman is how he kills indiscriminately. You do most often play as a woman, so the classic horror trope of women in peril is present. But Scissorman ain't trying to be a subtle abstinence or anti-drug allegory, killing people because they're having sex or smoking pot like Jason Voorhees. Scissorman just wants to butcher people. The story does reveal that there's a little more to his motives than that, but there's certainly an appeal to a maniac who takes pride in just being a good old-fashioned maniac. Probably the thing that really makes Clock Tower shine is its graphical delight and impressive cinematic camera movements. Director Hifumi Kono wears his love for cinema on his sleeve, and Clock Tower endeavors to be a visual experience certainly unseen in its day. The game is full of little moments, small details, and flashy set pieces. As mentioned before, it's no secret that the early years of polygonal gaming were rough. If Human Entertainment were a bigger studio with more resources, a lot of the game's cooler cinematics would have probably been farmed out to an animation studio, as was the common practice at the time, or been cut altogether due to the difficulty of rendering these scenes with in-game assets. By either desperation or brazen stupidity, Mr. Kono and his team really went for it, creating pragmatic camera movements and Scissorman gags that don't require loading so you're never taken out of the game. On a surface level, the visuals are very rough, but beneath the surface, I found the passion to be unmistakable. Clock Tower is a game with a lot of heart. It's a little horror game that could. And now it's trivia time, or let's embarrass everyone who commented before they watched the whole video. Clock Tower creator Hifumi Kono has been a lifelong fan of films, especially the work of Dario Argento. First Fear, for example, borrows heavily from his film Phenomena. Mr. Kono claims the inspiration for Scissorman came from the movie poster of The Burning. A self-proclaimed fan of The Exorcist, I've speculated that a memorable scene in Exorcist 3 may have also influenced Mr. Kono. As mentioned before, the Clock Tower series first started on the Super Famicom, aka the Japanese Super Nintendo, in September 1995. This first game was never released outside of Japan, though a fan translation has been available for some time. It was ported to the Japanese PC and PlayStation 1 in 1997, and also, of all systems, the WonderSwan in late 99. Our game, which is technically the sequel, was released in Japan in late 96, in North America in fall 97, and in Europe in early 98, and is the only game in the series that directly follows another. The next Clock Tower game was named Clock Tower Ghosthead in Japan, and Clock Tower 2 Struggle Within in North America. Not only is it a spin-off without Scissorman, it's also a half-baked pile of garbage, probably the worst horror game I've ever played. Europe was spared this teeming pile of junk. Clock Tower was never really a hit, and Human Entertainment had to file for bankruptcy in January of 2000. It's a hell of a way to kick off the new millennium. Though Mr. Kono still expressed interest in developing more Clock Tower games with his new company Nudemaker, yes, that is the name, and yes, they have made adult games, the rights were bought up by Sunsoft, who with Capcom co-developed the final official installment in the series, just named Clock Tower 3. Finally, someone decided to cut down on this branding catastrophe. This name fits as it's the third true game in the series in Japan, and the third game released in North America, though I'm sure it had Europeans confused. Clock Tower 3 was reportedly a flop, basically killing the series. The Clock Tower copyright stayed with Sunsoft, while Capcom released a spiritual successor, Haunting Ground, in the spring of 05, also notably furthering Capcom's pro-dog agenda of the mid-aughts.
Hey, it's that dog.
Unfortunately, Haunting Ground flopped as well, though due to a cult following, it has become one of the more rare and expensive games on the PS2. After this, the series was dead, and I do mean very literally, as, according to this document, the Clock Tower copyright was abandoned in January of 2008, though I'm not sure exactly what that means in legalese. But fast forward to 2014, where at the Tokyo Game Show, Mr. Kono announced Project Scissors, a brand new point-and-click horror game featuring collaborations with Masahiro Ito of Silent Hill fame, The Grudge director Takahashi Shimizu, and Metal Gear Solid 4 composer Nobuko Toda. At the time of producing this review, not much about the game had been revealed, but hey, too often these videos end on a down note, so here's hoping that Project Scissors, whatever that ends up being, turns out alright.
I know what you're thinking. This has been a video review of a video game with jump scares in it. You're expecting jump scares, I bet, but trust me, no jump scares. I promise. I know the best place to put a jump scare would be like at the end of a video, you know, but not gonna happen. I promise. No jumps. You can trust me. You're safe. Thanks for watching.